Adam Stark here, and this is my newest rap. This is called You Aren't Welcome in My Dojo. Basically, I will be going over the lyrics, I will be simply reading them, and then I will be giving you my own transcribing of the lyrics, breaking them down, and giving any additional information I feel like I need to give out, and I will go through any Easter eggs and any hidden meanings that as well may have possibly popped up, and here we go. I'll just start reading from right from the top. You aren't welcome in my dojo. A lesson I will teach you, the essence is like a slow stroke. What happens next will leave you all scratching heads till your skin's torn. Alzheimer's in prison. You don't know what you're in for. Okay, so this part obviously is basically I'm saying, okay, in my metaphorical dojo, okay, this would be a place where ordinary writers would not be welcome. Anything less than legendary would not be welcome because you wouldn't be talented enough to survive here. And also to say you don't know what you're in for, that's a common saying that it means you don't know what you're getting yourself involved in. You wouldn't be very good at whatever the situation is. But also if someone's in prison, you can ask them, what are you in for? And that is basically saying, well, what's your crime? What was your charge? And so on and so forth. So if you had Alzheimer's, which is memory loss, frequent memory loss in prison, you would not know what you are in for in prison, of course. And you wouldn't know what you're in for anywhere. So you wouldn't know what you were in for in my dojo, in this example. So that's just a, you know, good way to start out this rap. I'm saying you don't know what, you have no idea what you would be in for. Because I'm calling, you know, most other people less than ordinary, very untalented writers, of course, mainly people in the music industry. All right, continuing on here. My metaphors are the deadliest. My enemies are envious, like a genie's bottle poured out. Wishing on my downfall is an empty wish. Okay, so what I'm saying is, okay, an empty wish is a common saying, which means it's you want for something, but it's just never going to happen. Such as in this example, specifically, I am stating my downfall. You're going to pray for my downfall, but I'm going to tell you that is not going to happen. My downfall is something that isn't going to happen. There is no chance of that. So you can just forget about it, basically, is what I'm saying to my enemies and stuff. And also, okay, wishes comes from a genie's bottle in mythology, of course. And if a genie's bottle is poured out, then of course there would be no wish. So it would be empty. It would be hollow, the bottle. So it would be a wish that could not possibly get granted, of course. Okay, continuing with the lyrics here. Get dressed for the season and put up ornaments and lights with no hesitation. Pull up my Christmas socks, then I'll get to decorations. Okay, so this is just a funny double meaning. And I did a bunch of punchlines in this particular rap about the, you know, late winter season, late part of the year seasons, holidays and such, because that's, you know, kind of a topic I really haven't touched on in my rhymes, and I wanted to put my own twist on it and stuff, of course, because that's what I always do. I always want to, you know, put my own imprint on everything, on every topic. And basically I'm saying, okay, if I am going to, you know, get to decorations, I'm saying, okay, but let me just put my Christmas socks on first. Then I'll get to decorations, of course, putting up lights, putting up stockings, decorating and doing all sorts of things, etc. But I'm also saying, okay, decorate shins is the double meaning here, because if I'm pulling up my Christmas socks would be covering my shins, of course, as well as my ankles and my feet and everything. But obviously, the point is I use the word shins because it rhymes perfectly with decorations. Decorate space shins works as a funny double meaning. So that is why I went with those particular words that I picked. The next line here is, your friend got his repo vehicle impounded. He must either have bad or no luck. He's considering starting a traveling mistletoe selling company on the road, but you have the money, so you decided to get a mistletoe truck. Okay, so this is just a funny double meaning, again, going with the season. Okay, so a repo vehicle, a repossession vehicle, it can be a tow truck. It doesn't necessarily mean that it is, but that's why I was vague about it and not specific in my setup. Because I'm saying, okay, if he lost it, in one part of this double implied meaning is, okay, you have the money, so you decided get him his old tow truck. Is that what you're going to do with the money? Because it got impounded. Is that what you want to do? Or going with his idea of considering to start a traveling mistletoe selling company on the road, which means he would be driving to sell these mistletoes, to get a mistletoe truck. Is that what you would want to do? Which one of those? Okay, they sound exactly the same. Get him his old tow truck or get a mistletoe truck. They sound exactly the same when you use the right pronunciations and enunciations on each of the syllables in this double implied meaning. So it's just a funny way of saying, okay, you decided this, but which one of these did you decide? Because they sound exactly the same. So just a funny way to, you know, go about a funny, you know, arrangement of possible things that happened to this gentleman. The next line is, buy and bring home a bunch of gifts for the December occasion on its way. Truckload of gifts for every night of Hanukkah. That's one long holiday. Okay, so this is a double meaning because I'm saying, okay, Hanukkah compared to traditional other holidays is longer. And so it's a long holiday because there's multiple nights of it, whereas that it's celebrated, whereas most holidays are just one single day. Okay, so one long holiday. And the double meaning here is because I said specifically, you're bringing home a bunch of gifts and a truckload of gifts. Okay, so that's saying a truckload of a bunch of things, that is a haul, H-A-U-L. And if you're doing it for every night of Hanukkah, then it's a haul a day, one haul every day. Every day there is a haul of things that you, gifts and such that you are bringing. So that's the double meaning there. One long holiday being Hanukkah and one long haul every day. One long haul a day because you are bringing a lot of different gifts. The next line here is, I screamed, hey, 9 candles isn't quite enough. He told me, what the fuck should I do? I replied, calm down and lighten up. So this is just a funny double meaning, again, going off of candles and stuff. And I'm basically saying, okay, the double meaning here, double implied meaning, is at the end of the line, lighten up or lighten up. Because, okay, to lighten up means to calm down, means to take it easy, means to, you know, stop being so aggressive, it means to take a breather, it means to relax, and so on and so forth. Okay, so to calm down and lighten up, as in, you know, stop what you're doing, stop being so aggressive. Common saying, but it's all, I'm also saying, okay, 9 candles isn't enough, which means that there should be more than 9 at least. And I'm answering the question by saying lighten up. So I'm telling you to calm down, the person in the example, and I'm telling them how many candles to light up at the same time. So it's just a funny double implied meaning there. So the next line here is continuing on with the idea of candles, and I'm saying, reprehensible behavior of mine causing public outrages next. Burning my table down with hot wax sticks made them vexed. Witnesses testified about Adam's candles. Okay, so this is a double meaning because at the very end I'm saying they testified about Adam's, that's me, Adam apostrophe S, scandals, and Adam's apostrophe S, candles. Okay, so this is a double implied meaning because in the setup I said hot wax sticks. Now that is candles, but I didn't say candles because I didn't want it to be repetitive and I didn't want the setup to get to ruin the, of course, the subject at hand here, which is that candles of mine burnt down my table. And that would be, of course, like, you know, like a case of arson. And so what I'm saying is that my scandal, which would be like burning a table down, which would make them pissed off, is something that witnesses would testify about. And of course, they would testify about my candles, because that was the thing that made them burn down. So it's just a funny double meaning going on again about using candles in these punchlines. The next line, but I gotta spend my money first before I face death. So I bid for the highest rated vault in an auction. That's a safe bet. Okay, so this is just an easy, cool little metaphor. So to make a gamble or to make a bet, those words mean the same thing. They're synonymous. Now, a safe bet is a slang term, which basically means that it's an easy gamble. It's a very low risk. It's a very high possibility of coming out ahead or victorious. And also, if I'm being literal, if I'm buying a vault, okay, another word for a vault is called a safe, then it would technically be a safe bet because I'd be buying a safe or a vault, which means the same thing. So just a cool little metaphor I created there. The next line is funny. I'm basically, you know, making fun of myself. I'm exaggerating, of course, but, you know, it's just a funny punchline. I'm saying, okay, I'm lazy and can't get out of bed. Legs feel like they weigh 500. I would get up if I owned a large mess of ice cream to fill my whole stomach. So I would be standing if only I could get a pile of it. And that's where this is a double implied meaning punchline. This one takes extremely precise pronunciation to actually pull it off to make it a double implied meaning. Because it's all about the end here. I'm saying that I can't get up because I'm just lazy. I can't get out of bed. All right, and I'm saying how I would get up is if I could get that ice cream, okay? And not just a little bit of it, but a whole pile of it, okay? And I'm saying if I could just get a pile of that ice cream, because I said if I owned a large mess of ice cream, I was very specific in my setup here to make this work. So if I could just get a large mess of this ice cream, then I would get a pile of it. But I'm also saying that, you know, being in pain and everything, being that I want to stand, I want to get out of bed, and if I could get up, I'll love it. So you got to use the sound of the P after the word up, get up. So the P sound, and then it goes to the next word, I'll, I apostrophe LL, and then in the, of course, love it. And of it works as the same sounds, but of course you got to mesh them together at just the right speed and just the right pronunciation to get a pile of it and get up, I'll love it. You have to do it at just the right, you have to be dead on accurate to make this a double meaning when you're actually performing this punchline and this rap. But it's basically saying, okay, if I'd be happy to eat all this ice cream, and I'd be happy if I could actually get up and stand up. So just a funny old punchline, just kind of making fun of myself and sorts. So this is just a really funny punchline. This is, if I say faggot or fuck and you penalize me because my guts offend yours, remember, if you flag this and say it's really a foul action, remember those are F words. Okay, so this is just a funny double implied meaning. This is just saying, okay, now, if my guts offend yours, guts as in, you know, me being brave enough to say words that piss people off for whatever reason, you know, it's not necessarily my fault that other people can be sensitive to certain words, but it's basically, and these words are nowhere near as sensitive as any of the other words that I do not use, so, you know, it's ridiculous. But nonetheless, what I'm saying is, okay, it's a foul action. A foul action means that it's not wanted. It's what, displeasing, it puts people off, it's not something you want or something like that, okay? And I'm saying, okay, a foul action, then I should remember those are F words, as in the letter F, because I'm saying faggot or fuck. Those are two words that are, you know, technically on the scale of things, they are offensive, and they start with the letter F. So those are F words. And there's a saying of, you know, don't use the F word. Well, it's, which one are you referring to? Well, I said both of them to make sure that I could make this punchline work. So if someone says, hey, don't use the F word, or don't use the F words, well, then obviously, since I already said them, then I already can say that, okay, you guys are labeling me as someone is using the F words. But I'm also saying, in a completely different punchline, that if you flag this, and to flag this, that can mean click on the video and report it, or click on this song and report it, click on this rap and report it on the internet. That's what flagging something is. And I'm saying it's a foul action, but to flag something and to foul action, those are ref words, R-E-F, referee words. referees say things like it's a foul and I'm going to flag this and here's a flag. You know, those are things that refs use. I'm talking basically about football referees, American NFL football referees. And it's just a funny way to make this a double meaning because F words are F words, A-R-E space F space W-O-R-D-S, and ref words, R-E-F space W-O-R-D-S. It's just funny because they sound exactly the same, and it works out in a comical way because I'm saying, remember, those are F words, faggot and fuck start with the letter F, and, you know, foul and flagging are ref words, referee words, but they're also start with the letter F. So that's where this works as a funny double meaning punchline. Just, you know, it's just my way of, you know, making a joke of how sometimes people take things way too seriously and people get extra sensitive about things that don't need to be addressed as a problem. But it's just one of those things where I always like to, you know, I like to piss people off sometimes. You got to do it. You know, it's a part of life. The next line is, I want to rap for an audience and people ask me, why wouldn't you? I'm not going to show up for less than $10. I say for one, ditch it, just not good enough. So this is just a funny double meaning punchline. This is just saying, okay, if anybody wants to know why I would not rap for a particular audience, I'm saying, okay, it's like a money situation, but it's in a funny way. I'm saying for less than $10, okay, any number less than 10 is one digit, one single digit, okay? So why in the world would I want to be performing for less than $10? But I'm saying also for one digit, it's not good enough because that'd be any number less than 10 is one digit only, not two. So I'm saying in that sense, but I'm also saying for one, ditch it. As in, just don't even do it. Just ditch the show. Ditch the offer. It's not good enough. So don't do it. And then in my, keep going on this line here. I said for offers more than that. As in, I'm keep it going with my second point. So for one, as in, it's part of a way of entering in your sentences by saying, well, for one, and then you name a reason. And then you say, and also, this is something to consider, to think about. So I'm saying for one, ditch it, don't do the idea, it's not good enough, and then continue with the next point you're going to make. But I'm also saying for one digit, it's not good enough. So just a funny way of making a double meaning through digit and ditch it. The way I set it up, particularly by saying less than $10 is when I'm not going to show up. So just a funny way of going about my business, as in literal business. And then continuing here, offers for more than that, I'm hopeful for the future and researching those venues. I'll be looking up. Okay, so this is funny because I'm basically saying that, okay, to be looking something up is to looking something up is researching. Okay, but also if I am being hopeful, then I am looking up, as in not looking down, but I'm looking up toward the future. I got my head held high. That's what being hopeful means. Looking up. That is just another way of saying that you have hope for the future, no matter what it is, whatever it happens to be. Okay, continuing here. You can't quite put your finger on it, but there's new entertainment to stow. You love new music, and your hands have paralysis. You're not looking for something too old. Now, this is a funny double meaning. This is too old slash saying to hold. Now the H is silent because if you say it fast enough, then it works as a double meaning because I'm saying you only like new music, so you're not looking for something too old because you like the new stuff. But I'm also saying your hands have paralysis, then obviously you're not looking to hold anything, so you're not looking for something to hold. And I set this up in a funny way because I said you can't quite put your finger on it. So then if your hands had paralysis, you literally couldn't put your finger on it. But also, it's a saying because if is the quote, you can't quite put my finger on it, it means, you know, you can't quite figure out what it is, but it's on the tip of your tongue. It's you almost got it figured out sort of thing. So it's just a funny punchline about, you know, it's just basically saying, well, these are two problems you have, and you gotta find a way to meet them in the middle. The next line is, if I gained 100 pounds and dress in all black only, what would happen if you'd spot it? I would hear people comment, wow, he's really got thick. Now, this is just a funny-ass double meaning. This is basically saying, okay, either way, I'm gothic, G-O-T-H-I-C, or I have got thick, okay, two words, G-O-T space, T-H-I-C-K. So I'm saying, all right, if I'm wearing all black, then you would probably think, wow, he's really gothic all of a sudden. A gothic person is somebody who wears all black, okay? But I'm also saying, okay, if I gained 100 pounds and you noticed it, as I mentioned in my setup, you spotted it, then you would say he has got thick. He is now a thick person. So it's just a funny-ass double-meaning punchline here. I'm making fun of myself here in this exaggerated instance. The next line is a funny double-meaning punchline. This is saying, a cult is following an idiot who erases his past. Boring and not too sharp. Must be someone dull eating the path. Okay, so what makes this one funny is basically I'm saying two different things. I'm saying you have someone who is not sharp. Now, sharp can mean literally sharp, as in something that is going to cut, like it is shaped to make a lot of damage happen, or I'm saying sharp as in intelligent. Now, if you're the opposite of being sharp is someone dull, okay? And I said the guy is an idiot, and I said they're not sharp, which could mean dull, of course. And boring, as I said in the setup, also means dull. And so I'm saying it could be someone dull leading the path. And I said specifically that this person leading the cult erases his past. So it could be someone deleting the path, because deleting is a synonym, of course, for erasing. So just a funny punchline here. This is a very talented triple meaning punchline, triple implied meaning punchline. This is me saying basically, all right, I'll read it. It goes, I'm lost when I watch TV anymore. It's scorching hot and sunny now, and I'm listening to this lady saying it's cold and windy of sorts. Meteorologist who's untruthful. Now, how would I classify to people what to be listening for? I'm thinking, hear false weather reports. So what makes this a triple implied meaning is the last couple words, okay? So I'm saying, hear false weather reports, as in right here falls what? And I'm telling you what this falls as. Does this fall as this category? Does it fall as this subject? Does it fall as this? I'm saying it falls as weather reports, because that is what I'm talking about. I'm talking about on TV meteorologists and a lady talking about it's cold, and even though I think it's scorching hot. Anyways, that's weather reports. And I am also saying that here falls weather reports, but I am not saying falls as in what's the subject going to be. I am saying specifically falls, capital F-A-L-L apostrophe S, weather reports. Because fall, another word for fall is autumn, which of course is the cold season right before winter, the cold, windy season. And I said specifically in my setup, it's cold and windy of sorts, so you would be hearing fall's weather reports. You would not be hearing spring's weather reports or summer's weather reports, obviously, so you'd be listening to fall's weather reports, as in the season of fall. But I am also saying, because I said specifically, the meteorologist is untruthful, so you would be hearing false weather reports. False, F-A-L-S-E, weather reports. False means something that is not true, because I said that they were untruthful. So this is a triple implied meaning punchline. This was just very talented. This was one that I created, and I thought this was a really cool way of, you know, bringing to light a subject that everybody knows about, of course, is watching TV and watching the weather, and I found a cool way to bridge together into a very talented triple implied meaning. The next line here is also a very talented triple meaning, triple implied meaning punchline, and it also has to do similarly with the idea and the subject of weather. Okay, so I said, speaking of weather, time for me to be the leader I will proudly proclaim. The atmosphere has to appear foggy and wet. Allow me to explain. I will start my leadership in our darkest hour, so the sky needs to be cloudy terrain. Okay, so the triple implied meaning comes at the very, very end of this punchline. I am saying that the sky needs to be cloudy to rain, R-A-I-N, as in the sky needs to be cloudy in order for the rain to come down, as in any type of rain that comes down, you need the clouds to do it. That's the pattern that weather follows. I am also saying that for it to rain and for this atmosphere I describe as being foggy and wet being synonymous with rain, and in the darkest hour in the sky, then guess what? The sky needs to be cloudy terrain, T-E-R-R-A-I-N. Terrain specifically, obviously, means, you know, that type of atmosphere, that type of area, that type of region. That's what it needs to be. A cloudy terrain is what it needs to be. And the third implied meaning is it needs to be cloudy to space rain, R-E-I-G-N. To reign in that sense means to rule over, to be the leader of, to be the king of, to be the lord of, and so on and so forth. And I said, basically, I will be the leader, I will proudly proclaim. That's what I said in my setup. And so here I am going on about saying, well, the way for this to happen, for me to be the leader, the king, and so forth, is it needs to happen in the darkest hour, because I said I will start my leadership in our darkest hour. So the sky needs to be cloudy to rain, for me to reign over everybody else, to be the king and the ruler of everybody else. Going along with, of course, it needs to be cloudy for rain to come down, and it needs to be a cloudy terrain in order for all this to work out. So this is just a very dope triple meaning punchline about me being a leader, and I found it a way for it to work to going along with these weather patterns as well. The next line is, some will try and stop me from being a flying superhero in a villainous way. All I have to do is leave here and get to my costume drawer, and then they'll say, I really hope Adam doesn't get to escape. So this is a double meaning. It's basically saying that if I'm a superhero, and what do I need to do if I'm going to my costume drawer to be a superhero? Well, commonly, this would be to put on your cape, your superhero cape. So that basically, they really don't want Adam, the superhero, to get to his cape, obviously. And also, I said in my setup that I have to leave here. And if they don't want me to leave to get to my cape, then they also don't want me to escape. Now, the word escape and the two-word conjunction his cape sound exactly the same, which allowed this to be a double meaning, a double implied meaning. You say it one way and it means two completely different things. Just a funny little punchline here. The next line is, I'm everywhere on the internet. Are you willing to share what Adam thinks? My body of work is like the anatomy of a bicycle. My movement depends on links. Okay, so this is very dope because you might not have been able to catch it the first time you hear it, but what I'm basically saying is, okay, on the internet, if you're going to share things of mine on the internet, of me, Adam Stark, things that are mine on the internet, you'd be sharing my internet links. Links on the internet, if you didn't realize, would be the specific websites and the URLs that you would find at the top of the webpage. Those would be my specific links, okay? And I'm saying that since all of my body of work, all the things I've done over the years, and all the hard work I've put into in all of my projects, rap and otherwise, if all of it is on the internet, okay, then my movement, as in my movement being my body of work, being my momentum, being my, you know, progress throughout the years, that sense of the word movement, it depends on the links, the internet links. But also, I am saying the anatomy of a bicycle. I'm comparing it because for a bicycle to move, it is literally dependent on links. Chain links is things that are going into the bicycle that are, you know, circular and patterns, and they you use the force of the pedals, and the pedals can't move without the chain links. Okay, so your bicycle depends literally on links to move. But I'm also saying movement as in my progression and everything over the years. My, you know, my power, my prowess, and everything depends on internet links. And I'm comparing that to what it takes for a bicycle to move. So just a dope way of throwing out there that I can, you know, say, well, my movement depends on the links on the internet, but it's also just as easy as saying that my movement is like how a bicycle moves, which is also dependent on links. So just a dope way of putting that together. The next line is, every road I go down, there's more for me to find. Y'all don't want me to. You wish I'd stop and see my feet decline. Too late, you want me to stop before I see more traffic. 10 cans of spray paint couldn't get me to redesign. Okay, so this one is a double meaning. It takes a lot of work to pronounce it right and to enunciate this just right for it to work. But I'm basically saying, okay, you guys don't want me to keep moving in this direction, right? You don't want me to keep going down this road. You'd rather have me stop, as in literally and as in physically and as in, you know, you don't want me to rep anymore. Well, what I'm saying is, okay, to get traffic. Now, that means many different things. Of course, traffic can mean a bunch of cars on the road. Obviously, traffic can also mean a lot of attention and notoriety. Okay, that's what it can mean. And I'm saying you don't want me to see more traffic. Well, I'm saying no matter, even if there's a stop sign, you could not get me to read that sign because I'm going to get more traffic. Traffic as in notoriety, as in fame, and so on and so forth. So, but I did this in a dope way by saying, even if I had 12 cans or 10 cans of spray paint, you could not get me to read this sign. And I'm saying you also couldn't get me to redesign. Because what are you doing when you're spray painting something? You are redesigning it. You are physically changing what it looks like. So you couldn't get me to read that stop sign and obey it, as in to not go toward the literal traffic. And I'm also saying, you know, nothing's going to stop me from getting my traffic, as in my fame, fortune, notoriety, and my views and stuff. Nothing's going to stop me. So just a cool way of saying, you know, you couldn't get me to read that stop sign no matter what. And even if I had a bunch of spray paint with me, you couldn't get me to see that stop sign, and you couldn't get me to redesign the where it was. It takes a lot of work, but if you say it just right at the right speed, you can say redesign and read this sign, and it sounds exactly the same. The next line is, help another group go on a crusade mission sooner, or you'll get left behind like a U-turn. I can teach you all to be great. You'll observe and watch, saying, teach me while I make money. Boy, I'll learn a lot. Okay, so this is very dope. So the first thing I'm saying is, you know, to help another group, you are going on a crusade. Okay, a crusade, going on a mission, completing an objective. But also a cruise aid. Crew, apostrophe S, aid. Because a group, it would be a crew, and a crew, apostrophe S, aid. And a crusade, but a cruise aid. Because you're helping them, you're giving them aid. So that's just a really cool double meaning for the setup. And then I'm saying, or you'll get left behind. Now, to get left behind obviously means you'll get held back. You will not be helped yourself, and you will be, you know, left all alone by yourself. And that's you know, something nobody wants, I'm saying. Now, and I said, compared it in a simile, I said you'll get left behind like a U-turn, which is dope because the thing about similes is when I use them, I like to make them in very creative ways. Now, the thing about left behind like a U-turn, that's being very literal. I'm saying, what do you do when you're making a U-turn? You are turning left, and then you are going behind the direction that you were physically just facing before, because you'd be facing forwards, of course. So you'd literally turn left and then go behind in that direction. So it's being very literal about what a U-turn is. But I'm also saying, of course, you'll get left behind, as in you will, you know, you'll be basically putting yourself in a position, you'll be alienating yourself to be by your, you'll be solo, you'll be lonesome, because, you know, you could have helped someone else out, and instead, you know, you're being selfish. And I'm trying to say that's something you don't want. And the last part of this line here that is very dope is a double meaning. I'm saying, I can teach all of you to be great, so just listen to me, listen to what I'm saying, okay? And then you would be telling me, in literal words, I'm, you know, making a quote for the people listening to me, saying, you know, basically, teach me while I make money. Boy, I'll learn a lot. Now, the double meaning here is at the last couple words, because the thing is, I'm saying, boy, I'll learn a lot, and boy, I'll earn a lot, because learning is listening and being taught something. Earning is, of course, making money. And I, as I said in my setup specifically, I said, teach me while I make money, and guess what? You will learn a lot, and you will earn a lot. And the L coming from the word I'll, I apostrophe LL, is a very easy way to disguise it, so you could easily pull off the word learn or earn. I'll earn or I'll learn. It's a very easy way to make double meanings when you slide the last letter of one word over into the next one, especially in cases where it's a plural word. But anyways, this one is very dope, because, I mean, how much easier can it get? I'm saying, you want to learn and you want to, or excuse me, you want me to teach you something and you want to make money, and you'll be, in your quote, you'd be saying, boy, I'll learn a lot. In other words, you'll learn a lot and earn a lot, but you're saying it in one way, making it a double implied meaning. So very dope. I'm pretty sure everybody figured this one out the first time. The next line is, first of all, recollect one's past. No enhancements or time machines for unveiling my job. Looked at my own toddler photo albums personally, and the naked eye saw. Okay, so this is a very dope double meaning. Okay, what I am saying is, okay, if there is no time machines, okay, then what happens when I look at my own toddler photo albums, as in toddler pictures of myself, me at an extremely young age, okay, what is going to happen is I am going to see a kid, of course, as in myself, but I will be seeing a kid. So then a kid I saw. But the double meaning here is I also said the naked I saw. I said specifically no enhancements, and you have to recollect one's past by looking at past photo albums. And I said that I looked at my own photos from my toddler photo albums personally, and that would be done with the naked eye. So just a cool double meaning there. The next line is very funny. It's just a hilarious double meaning punchline. It goes, I'm right-handed. If it could talk, it would insult my left hand and proclaim its status that it covets. Okay? Talk to the left hand and say, between us, I'm the toughest. Okay, so this is just a hilarious double meaning. I'm just saying, okay, it's just creativity at its finest. That's all it is. My brain goes in crazy places, and this is one of them. I'm saying, if my hands could talk to each other, they would have egos, right? And my right hand would be bragging, saying that between all the hands, I am the toughest. But also, I said specifically, it's talking to the other hand, being only one other hand. The right hand's talking to the left, and it would proclaim that its status being that it's stronger. And it would say, I'm the tough fist, which is just hilarious because that's what a hand does. And especially when you're talking about hand strength, you would probably envision a fist. So that's why I'm saying I'm the toughest and I'm the tough fist between the two hands. Okay, so it's just a funny double meaning punchline here. All right, I am very excited to talk about these punchlines personally. Okay, so this is the end-all be-all. It goes, do you wish to know why they call me Dr. Stark? Which is, of course, one of my aliases in the rap game. I go by Dr. Stark. And I mention my brain chemistry wields. the greatest punchlines related to the medical field. So basically, I'm giving you a compilation of specific punchlines that have to do with the medical field that are medically inclined and medically related. But I did them in a very talented way, in a very skilled way of using multiple meanings so that these punchlines work and they could be used to show, okay, if you're going to give me the name Dr. Stark and I don't have any real medical credentials, well, this would be a nice, you know, excuse to go by is that, well, I have created some amazing punchlines for the, you know, sake of saying you can call me Dr. Stark because I have the greatest punchlines ever made that involve the medical field and medical science. Okay, albeit that they are funny, but they are very skillfully created. So, anyways, the next one that comes on here has to do with that is, quote, okay, I'm very scientific with my internal teachings. I'm not a priest, but at the last moment of recognition, there's funeral readings. So the double meaning here is at the very last part of the rhyme, funeral readings and funeral readings. Okay, because what does a priest do at a funeral? It's their last moment of recognition of their life. That's what happens at the funeral. That is the last moment of any individual's recognition of their life. Is the priest will give them their final words, their final goodbye. They will move them on, you know, to the afterlife and everything. And that's the last time you take note of that person's life in the physical form. Is during the funeral. So there's funeral readings, of course. And also I'm saying at the last moment of recognition physically of life, medically speaking, there is funeral readings. Why is that? Because the neural readings are, of course, your life readings. You know, your heart beating, your pulse, you know, the last few minutes of you being alive on this world would be your neural readings. And if you are almost dead, if you are almost out of this world, physically speaking, in life and everything, that would be your neural readings. And there would only be a few of them, of course, because you're not going to have a lot of neural readings if you're still alive and well. But as you are taking that last, you know, depth into, you know, the afterlife, that's what you're going to find, just a few neural readings. Now, continuing here, the next a very amazingly written punchline that I've created and for the medical field is me basically going on about two amazing doctors that invented a tool that we see all the time in doctors' offices. I am, of course, referring to the otoscope. So the line goes like this. Look up to the inventors before us, the greatest minds revered. Ignaz Gruber and E. Siegel were doctors, and they invented the otoscope to keep eye on ears. So this is a double meaning, and it can be interpreted two different ways. But it is not a triple meaning. It is a double meaning, but it can be interpreted in two different possible ways. The only reason you would see on the screen that there is two slash marks next to it is because it's an interpretation. So in other words, you can look at it three ways, but it is only implied in two meanings, okay? It is not a triple implied meaning, okay? Anyways, so these two doctors in the early 20th century, Ignaz Gruber and E. Siegel, they invented the otoscope. They did different things, but they both take major credit for inventing this very useful tool that we have seen and that we've all, you know, been used on, and we've, you know, it's a very common tool. And what this tool does is it allows the doctors to look inside of your ears, and they put their eye up to it, and they look inside of your ears. So I said these guys invented the otoscope to keep eye on ears, because that is literally what they do with it, to keep an eye on your ears, physically, literally, every way you can think of, because that's what the tool is for. But I also mentioned both of their names, and I said that they are two key pioneers, because they are pioneers since they invented a useful tool that has been used for, you know, decades later and will be used now for a very long time and forever, because that's what pioneers do. They invent something that is a useful tool or item or strategy or culture or lifestyle or of sorts. That is, you know, forever, we are forever thankful for the things that have been created from people like these. And I'm also saying they invented the otoscope too, as in T-O-O, as in not only were they just revered doctors, which is already amazing. Anybody that's a doctor, that's awesome. But I'm saying, but as well, or to, T-O-O, which also means as well, they are key pioneers, you know, for inventing the otoscope. So it's just a very dope double meaning, because I'm saying they invented the otoscope for the ability to keep an eye on ears of their patients, but I'm also saying they invented the otoscope. Two key pioneers. You know, that's what they are. They're two key pioneers in the medical field. So just a very dope double meaning here in relation to, you know, medical history and stuff, and keeping in mind that this is a reason that I say that you can call me Dr. Stark. The next line in the compilation of lines for which I can give reasons to call me Dr. Stark is a very funny, very humorous punchline. It is a double implied meaning punchline. It is a very long-winded one, but for good reason. Once you see the timeline of events, it is just hilarious, and it's very skillfully written. It goes, I've conducted an experiment for my medical exam during which I will watch a team of two people working, an idiot and a genius together. I'm mostly concerned with how each other comes to terms with their individual studying methods for learning. The smarter group member creates a song from the material and recites it, while the other is absurdly highlighting, scribbling angrily, and cursing. The exam has multiple portions with different topics for ensuring their grade earnings determined. Basically, you would see one part neurological and one part nursing. Okay, so I know that was a lot, but here is why this is very talented. It all comes down with the very last couple of lines in this rhyme. It's saying this, okay? You have an idiot and a genius working together. And the other more important thing to understand it that is, this is a multiple portioned exam, as in there is multiple topics on this exam. And I mentioned specifically all those things I just said. So what I'm saying is I am concerned with how each other comes to terms with their each of their studying methods, being that they're different, and to see how they do on this exam, which is multiple portions. So basically it comes down to I mention what those portions of this exam are. And also by doing that, since I make this a double implied meaning, is I mention the differences between the partners. Okay, so I got what I wanted out of it, to see the differences with the partners, and I got to explain what the different portions of the exam are, talently, skillfully done, because I was able to put this together with a long setup, but with words and conjunctions of words and sounds to make it a double implied meaning. So it comes down to the ending. I'm saying, as far as the two group members, there's one partner illogical, as in not smart, as in he's an idiot, he's very stupid, he can't use logic or critical thought, and one partner sing. You see one partner sing. Why? Because I mentioned in my setup that the smarter partner, what he did was make a song out of the material, and he would recite it. That was his studying method, a very smart one. And the other one, as I mentioned, was just absurdly highlighting and angrily scribbling and stuff and cursing. Like, he just was an angry guy, and he was just highlighting and scribbling stuff, and it wasn't going to get him anywhere. And I said the word absurdly, of course, on purpose. Anyways, so I said one partner is illogical and one partner sing. That's what you would see, because the one partner was going to sing to recite his material and remember it in a song. And the other part that makes this a double implied meaning is the two different portions of this exam. I said one part neurological and one part nursing. Okay, neurological, that is a type of medical exam you would have to take. A neurological exam, that is a term used to, you know, describe exactly what you'd be studying in the medical field and a test you would have to take eventually. So I'm saying one part of this exam I've been mentioning in my setup is a neurological exam, and the other part of this test is a nursing exam. And this works as a very funny double meaning, because the point is nursing one part nursing sounds exactly the same as one partner sing, and one part neurological sounds exactly the same as one part neurological, one partner illogical, one part neurological. Very dope, very crazy double meaning here. Just a funny one. And again, it all has to deal with medical field related punchlines because I always want to prove myself, whatever it is. There's nothing I like better doing than pushing the boundaries of the English language to proving that I am talented, to prove that I am someone worth listening to prove that I am someone original. And so I say, well, how many people, by the way, are named Doctor? You know, have doctor in their alias. I'm talking about, not talking about real people. I'm talking about in the music industry, in whatever, just for fun, they use it. Well, I'm saying, okay, I am clearly not a real doctor, but I'm giving people reasons to call me Dr. Stark, because find me any better punchlines that are in the medical field that you can relate to than the ones that I have given today. See, these are very talented, skillfully done, multiple meanings, implied meanings. You know, anybody can make a punchline about the medical field. It's not hard to do that. But to do it as talented as I have done, you will not find someone else doing that. I don't care what anyone says. I'm not going to see it happen. It just won't happen. And I've proved it here today. So that is why they call me Dr. Stark. And I'm proud to say that. The next triple implied meaning punchline goes like this. I, too, am a man of many talents. Allow me to demonstrate. I'm expecting company for whom I'm cooking, but in a twist of fate, I lost track of time and accidentally broke all of my platters, but I didn't give up faith. I'm a broken dish repairer and a cook. I won't be ready on time, but I can still fix a plate. Okay, so basically, this is what I'm saying. Time was of the essence. I wasn't on time. I wasn't early or on time, even. I was late. So I said, don't worry, I can still fix up late. So that's what I can do. I can fix this problem and it's just going to be late. Not going to be on time. And also, I am saying that I am a cook. And a common saying, very common saying, is you can fix a plate, which means you can cook something, which means you can, you know, prepare a meal. That's what it means to fix a plate. Very common saying, very common phrase, and I used it here, and I mentioned that I was a cook and that I'll get it done. Also, I said all my platters were broken. Platters are plates. They're synonymous, okay? And platters, plates were broken. And I said, don't worry, I'm a broken dish repairer, so I can literally fix a plate. A plate being broken, I can fix a plate. So I can do all three of those things. And I said it by saying I can fix up late, and I can fix a plate. Fix a plate meaning to literally fix a broken dish of a plate, and I can fix a plate as in cook a meal. Now, what we have here is another time in my history where I have made an entire story out of using only double and triple implied meanings. So this is very, very talented. It's an entire story. So let me just start right from the top. It goes, next lesson, in essence, is best depicted in telling a story. Listen to this anecdote using double and triple entendres for earning better scoring. Here's the story now. Since my dollars aren't on track, I made a money run to get this payment. Took a hostage to empty her savings so I could take it. She said to call the cops, so I made the bank teller to withdraw the statement. So, the reason that this one is very dope, okay, what I'm saying is, first I said my dollars aren't on track, which is a common saying. It just means, you know, I'm not doing a good job of saving up. I'm not being frugal with my money. I'm not on track. To be on track with something, it means you're doing a good job, as in you are, you know, pursuing your goals successfully, basically. And I specifically said my dollars aren't on track. They are not on track. Okay, and also it's just, I said, they aren't on track, and I said, I should make a money run to make this payment. Now, track is running, you know, to be track and field, that's running. A money run, my dollars aren't on track, money run, that's just some wordplay there. It's not a double meaning or anything, it's just some cool little wordplay I added to spice it up. Okay, now I'm saying that I took a hostage, right, to empty out her savings so I could take it. Okay, I'm going to the bank. I, you know, pull out a weapon. I make her a hostage. I want her to empty out her money so I can be rich from it and everything. And I'm saying, here's where the double meaning comes in, is I made the bank tell her to withdraw the statement. So the double meaning here is with bank teller and bank tell her to withdraw the statement. So when you are in the bank, if you've ever been to a bank, you know this. The banks have statements of money, how much is used, how much is taken out, how much is earned, how much is fiscally created over the years, and so on and so forth. So when you are going to take money out of a bank, even in a hostage situation, you are going to make a withdrawal, and you are going to withdraw the statement of money that you're going to make, no matter what it is. That is the statement, that is the amount of money, and you are going to withdraw the money, even if it's by force in a hostage situation. That's what you do. So I made the bank teller withdraw the statement. Now, a bank teller is the person, the employee, that is responsible for that transaction. Even if it's illegal and it's done by force, that's what the bank teller does. They take care of that for me. And I also, making this a double meaning, because I am saying that the bank, or that she said to call the cops, excuse me. And so I made the bank tell her to withdraw the statement, as in the literal statement, as in a sentence that was specifically said by somebody. The statement, I told them to withdraw the statement about calling the cops, as in withdraw, as in to take back the statement about they're going to call the cops. I wanted that to be withdrawn as well as money withdrawn literally. So it's just a dope double meaning there, and it's, again, has to do with the whole story, making this very talented in this realm of storytelling, but I'm doing it in a very talented way of using only double and triple implied meanings. The next rhyme in this story is, to make my getaway, I stole my enemy's shitty car as well as its remnants. He fought back and cut my hand, and as a result, I bled from this. I converted its moving parts into motion for retribution. That is describing the power of vengeance. So, this is a very dope double meaning, and I don't know if anybody could have caught this the first time. If they did, if you did, props to you, that is awesome. So what I am saying here, okay, I made my getaway from the bank from stealing money, taking a hostage, and so I said specifically, I stole my enemy's shitty car. Okay, if it's a shitty car, it means it's not very good condition, it's very bad, and everything in the car I stole as well, its remnants. Okay, I said he fought back, so there was a struggle, a physical confrontation. I said that he cut my hand, and as a result, I bled from it, okay? And so, in retribution for that, okay, I got vengeance. Okay, vengeance is retribution. Those words mean that are, well, they're synonymous with each other. They're very similar. So I said in retribution, and I got vengeance for that because he cut my hand, I bled from it, and I got his car. And also, I said, now I mentioned specifically that his car is shitty, and I said that I converted moving parts into motion, and that is literally the definition of an engine. Is converting moving parts into motion. So I got his shitty car to work. I got the engine to actually function. So since I specifically said I converted moving parts into motion, I literally described the power of engines. And I'm also saying, since I did it in retribution, that I am describing the power of vengeance. See, of, O-F, vengeance, and of engines. They sound exactly the same. It just, it all has to do with the word of, because it blends in that sound. The V and the F blends in together when they're two different words being combined, and they have the same number of syllables. So just a very dope double meaning continuing along the story. The next rhyme in my multiple meanings story is very funny. What I'm saying is here, okay, I started planting my alibi for the cops. Between 3:55 and 4:05 store lurking, I maintained I was shopping and searching for a time-telling device I'd bought. My alibi was that I was shopping around 4 o'clock. Okay, this is just hilarious. This is, I'm pretty sure everybody understood the double meaning in this one the first time they heard it, because I used like a very easy setup here, and I'm hoping everybody got it the first time. But if not, it's just really funny. So what I'm saying is, okay, if I am doing this shopping that I'm maintaining for my alibi, okay, and I'm saying that it took place between 3:55 and 4:05, that means it took place around 4 o'clock, because 5 minutes before 4 o'clock, 5 minutes after 4 o'clock, that's obviously around the time of 4 o'clock. So that's while I worked in the one meaning. Now, the double meaning here is I maintained that I was lurking and shopping and searching for some time-telling device, which would mean that I was shopping around for what? What was I shopping around for? For a clock. And 4 o'clock and 4 o'clock sounds exactly the same. So it's just a very funny double meaning here, continuing on with the story. The next rhyme in the story is a triple implied meaning punchline. This is just absolutely dope, very impressive. I was really glad I got to pull this one off. It took me a while to write, but it is awesome. So then continuing with the story here as well, the lines go like this. I did get arrested, but I acquired reasonable doubt to help my case first. Not one authority figure saw my suspicious tattoo or the place where I washed my hands. This included investigators. So here is the triple meaning here, okay? I am saying that if you were going to, you know, convict me in court and everything, you need a lot of hard evidence. And I said, basically, the point of this is that I'm spraying reasonable doubt all over the case. So in one way, I am saying that my suspicious tattoo is unable to be seen. So this ink eluded investigators. Ink is slang, but very common slang for a tattoo. So this ink eluded investigators. I am also saying they cannot find the place where I washed my hands. So this sink eluded investigators. Because where would I wash my hands? A sink. And I'm saying that sink eluded investigators. They can't find the sink where it is because of my bleeding hands, which would be a good, you know, solid evidence to use against me. And I'm also saying, of course, this included investigators. Okay, so that's triple meaning. That is a triple implied meaning. You say it one way. You do have to use at the right speed and kind of the right oomph in your pronunciation to pull this off. But I am saying that in all my reasonable doubt, my ink or my suspicious tattoo that would have been used as hard evidence, that eluded investigators. The sink where I washed my bleeding hands, that eluded investigators. And I was saying that basically that, okay, not one authority figure saw it, okay? And then I mentioned this includes investigators. I said that in a vague way of authority figures because that can technically mean a lot of different kinds of people. So since it included investigators, the people that would harm my defense the most, that's why it worked out. And this is a very talented triple implied meaning here, and it worked well with the story. The next rhyme is, the next thing was an awkward drug test. Even though I was completely sober, I had become stressed. He peeped over the cover and at my privates while I filled my peak up, checked the amount. Now I should complain about this awkward incident mixed with those eyes making a mean mug. I mean, depending on who you are, what would you do in this situation if all of a sudden I speak up? Now, this is just a very hilarious double meaning. I'm basically saying, okay, if I feel like I'm being violated, like you are looking at my private parts and here I am, you know, doing my drug test, okay? Even I was completely sober, as I mentioned, okay, in my setup. I'm saying you're looking at my privates. Now, what would you do if I speak up, as in I register a complaint? Because I said I should complain about how awkward this incident was. But I'm also saying, depending on who you are, because what if you're the other person, what would you do if all of a sudden eyes peek up? EYES space PEAKS peak space up UP. What would you do if all of a sudden eyes peak up, as in looking at the privates? Like, what would you do in that situation? And I'm also saying, what would you do if I speak up, as in I tell my story about this and register a complaint? So it's just a very funny, awkward part of the story that goes along with it, but it's just a hilarious double implied meaning as well. Next rhyme in the story is, next was the trial court and my sentencing. The suspense could have killed me. All I had on my side was professionals representing my medical history. Surgical operation that ruined my brain's functioning ability. The male judge asked, do we have a verdict? And they answered him quickly. Yes, sir, jury found the defendant unable to intently perform the crimes committed, so he is not guilty. So this is just a very funny double meaning, double implied meaning punchline here, but it also goes very well with the story. It has to do with the jury's answer. Is they answered, I said specifically a male judge, so you would call him sir, of course, not ma'am or anything. You'd call him sir. So I'm saying the jury would say, yes, sir. Jury found, you know, so on and so forth, not guilty. You can't be guilty. But also, they are speaking on behalf of, there was a medical, in my medical history, there's some medical evidence that suggested in the story that there was a surgical operation that ruined my brain's functioning ability. So they're also, in the double meaning, is the jury saying, yes, surgery found the defendant unable to intently commit these crimes. And if you can't prove intent, then of course the case could be thrown out. And I'm saying in this case it was, and I could not be found guilty. So it comes down to, yes, sir, jury found the defendant, or me saying, yes, surgery found the defendant unable to intently commit this crime. So it all came down to, there was a medical procedure, I'm saying, that basically made my brain unable to properly, you know, assess situations, and so I couldn't have intently done something if my brain was, you know, altered with that badly from some godforsaken bad surgery. And so with my reasonable doubt and with doctors on my side saying, testifying, yep, his brain was altered with from some bad surgery. So just a very dope double meaning, and it's a very cool way of saying, look, I got off of this crime, and in a funny way, because it's a double implied meaning, too. When the jury's speaking, you can hear both sides of the same result, but done very skillfully and talentedly, you know, written together. And the ending rhyme of my story goes, and besides, they made a legal error in my trial. I can make an argument. Just looking for some fame no matter how, but now the court's over, I confess to all of it. The prosecutor wanted to drain my energy. However, I'm a machine from the future. Rare and hard to get. Since there's no outlet for me, what were they going to charge me with? The end. Okay, so this is just a very hilarious way to end the story. I'm saying, okay, if I am from the future, right? And I said I'm a machine from the future, by the way. But if I'm from the future, then there is not going to be the right kind of technology to charge me. You know, every machine needs to be charged in some way, shape, or form. And I'm saying, if I'm from the future, you're not going to have an outlet to charge me with, because of course, you would have only outdated technology, right? And I'm also saying that, of course, I was only looking for fame no matter how I got the fame. I was looking for fame, so that's the reason I did those crimes, apparently. And I'm saying, since there's no outlet for me, as in what do you do when you need an outlet, there's a plug outlet, but there's also an outlet is another phrase that means to try and get some fame, like your means of getting it. Like the internet is an outlet for people to get fame. The radio is an outlet for people to get fame, you know, so on and so forth. So what I'm saying is there wouldn't be an outlet for me to do any of that, but also I'm saying there is literally no outlet for me because I'm a machine from the future. And so what would you charge me with? Now, the charge me with is the funny part of the double implied meaning. Okay, charge me with a crime. Okay, well, what would you charge me with? There is no outlet for me. I'm a machine from the future. Okay, so how exactly would you be able to, you know, sentence me to something and charge me with the crime when I'm a machine from the future? But I'm also saying, if you were to literally want to charge me, as in charge up my battery, give me a resurgence of energy or something, how would you do that? I'm a machine from the future. There's no such thing as an outlet for me, an acceptable, power source for me. So there is no outlet for me. So what would you possibly charge a machine from the future with? You know, so it's just a very funny way to end the story in a double implied meaning. So there you go, another example of me making an entire story with only multiple implied meanings in them. So it's not just a story, it's a skillfully, technically written story. Reminiscent of another one I've done called Confessing My List of Crimes, where every single part of that story is also multiple implied meanings. Now, the very end of this rap is me creating yet another new type of punchline. I am being an innovator again, and I made an entire new invention of a new type of punchline that I have just created. So I'll continue on with the lines here and specifically how it goes. So it goes, now it's time I show you my new invention. It's the coolest method. It's where I give you the ending sentence and we review how many interpretations could be connected. So basically what this is, I give a number of examples and I will say just a fragment of a sentence or a whole sentence. And then I will say, well, was I really trying to say this as the meaning for the sentence or this? Or am I saying both? Because you know me, I am very good at making multiple implied meanings. So it's just a very cool, unique invention that I came up with, where instead of, you know, giving you the whole punchline where it's, you know, here's the setup, and then here's the ending rhyme, and then it's, okay, well, it means either one thing, or it means two things, or more. Okay, instead, this time, I am giving you the fragment, and then I want people to try and guess. What is he trying to say when he gives me this example? Is it this, or is he gonna say this, or is it more than one thing? And so it's just a very cool, dope new method that I came up with, and now I will go over them. Here we go. First example. Quote, an egg rolls down the hill. Am I saying I lost part of my Asian lunch selection? Or is this a physics lesson on a chicken's nest once an egg is intercepted by the wind's progression? Or both? So basically what I'm saying here is I give you the simple fragmented sentence, an egg rolls down the hill. So then you have to guess, okay, what am I trying to mean by that? Because it could mean any one of these things. So the point is to listen to that first sentence and try and think, what is Adam trying to convey? Or what could he possibly mean by just saying something like that? And then now you'll find out, okay, am I saying I lost part of my Asian lunch selection? Because egg rolls is a common Asian food that you can eat. And am I saying I lost an egg roll and it's down the hill? Or am I saying basically that there is an egg, and it is rolling down the hill because the wind is making it do so? Okay, and I said that in a fancy way by saying, is it like a physics lesson where a chicken's nest, where an egg has been intercepted by the wind's progression? As in, is that all I'm saying? Is that the wind took an egg out of a nest and made it roll down the hill? Or am I saying both? And you know it very well could be both, because this is Adam Stark we're talking about, who always makes multiple implied meanings. Second example, quote, the bank quits on me, unquote. Am I saying I'm responsible for cooking all the food for an event? Or am I saying that my bank just had enough and has given up? Or both? So what's funny about this is, okay, the bank quits on me. So am I basically saying that the banquet, as in banquet, and then apostrophe S, the banquet's on me, the banquet is a eating event, okay? Food for an event, you know, a dining occasion or something like that. I'm saying, is that all on me? As in, is that my responsibility to cook all the food for the event known as a banquet? Or am I saying the bank quits on me? As in, am I possibly saying that whatever my bank is, they just have had enough of me and they've just completely given up, which giving up and quitting means the same thing. Am I saying that? Or am I saying both, since I am known to make double implied meanings? So which one is it? Or is it both? It's just a cool way to think about this new punchline invention I've created. It's, you know, which way am I going with it? There's a lot to think about. There's always more than meets the eye. You listen to the sentence in the example, and you think it would just stop there, but who knows? Who knows where it could possibly go? And that's one thing I always want to make people understand, is that I'm one of the people that can do that. I can make a simple sentence go in many different directions, a simple idea go in many different directions, and in a skilled way, not in some corny, ridiculous way, but in a really talented, provably skilled way. Third example, quote, "I wanna stay at home, mom," unquote. Am I telling my mother that I object to leaving my residence, or am I claiming that I wish my mother would leave all of her paying jobs and then just quit, or both? So this is saying, okay, a stay-at-home mom, okay, that can mean that it is the term for a mother that her job is to stay at home with the kids, to not go to work, to not go to a place, to an occupation, as in their job is not a paying job. It just means that their whole life's work and dedication at that time is to stay at home with the kids and watch the kids and nurture them and feed them and give them chores and take care of them and all sorts of things like that. But it also, it could also mean if I'm saying, hey, I want to stay at home, mom, then it could also be me saying that I don't want to leave my house. Mom, as if I was talking to my mom, I want to stay home. I want to stay at home. I don't want to leave. So which one am I saying? Or am I saying both of them? That is the trick here. A simple sentence like that, it could go in either direction. So which one am I possibly saying? Or am I saying exactly both things? So it's a lot to think about, of course. Fourth example, quote, "Guess that makes me selfish," unquote. Am I sarcastically answering a question by saying that I think only about myself for personal gain? Or am I categorizing my job description for working at an amphibian pet shop place? Or both? So basically, sell fish and selfish. They sound exactly the same. And it's just one is a two-word conjunction, sell, space, fish, or the one word, selfish. So if I say, guess that makes me selfish, am I, you know, being rude and I'm answering someone by saying, okay, well, you know, whatever the argument is, and I'm answering you by saying, wow, I guess that makes me selfish, as in I guess that makes me only think about myself, answering it sarcastically, because that is something that you could do. You know, it's answering a question sarcastically or, you know, rudely agreeing with a negative point that somebody's trying to make to you in an argument is a possibility. So am I saying that? Or am I basically being literal and I'm talking about what my job is and am I describing it? If I work at an amphibian pet shop, and amphibian means fish, if I am working at a pet shop for fish, then I could technically, literally be saying that, yeah, I sell fish, because that's what amphibians are, and if I'm at a pet shop, then what would I be selling? Of course, pets, and I said it's an amphibian pet shop, so I'd be selling fish. Or am I saying both? Am I saying both of those things? Because since it's me and I'm very good at making multiple implied meanings, which direction are we going with the line, guess that makes me selfish? It's a very funny way to look at it. And which way could it be, or both? You know, it's all up to interpretation. Fifth example, quote, "Sir, 10 to 1, it's going to be busy," unquote. Am I telling this guy odds or giving him a time slot or both? In conclusion, you aren't welcome in my dojo. Now, this fifth example here is my personal favorite of this new punchline that I invented. Okay, because the thing is, that's a common enough saying. Okay, if you tell anybody 10 to 1, it's going to be this or it's going to be that. Okay, that's a common saying, which means it's very highly going to be what I am telling you, what I am guessing, what I am estimating. And that can be used, it is used very commonly, but it can be used for any topic. 10 to 1, when you go to this place, the traffic is going to be horrible on that highway. You know, and it's something you can use, and everybody is used it. It's so common. And then, so I said, okay, am I giving this guy odds? Because that's one possibility, and that's the most obvious possibility. You probably thought about that the first thing I said it, most likely, because that's what it is commonly used for when you say that saying. But also, I give another example. I said, or giving him a time slot, because you didn't realize, oh, wait a minute, 10 to 1, that could mean the time of 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock. So is that what I'm saying? That from 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock, it's going to be busy? Or am I saying both? That I'm giving him the odds that it's going to be busy, you know, no matter what. 10 to 1, it's going to be busy there. Or am I saying at that time, it's going to be busy there? Or am I saying exactly both of those things? Which one or both? So it just, that's my favorite example. I love that one. I thought that was a good way to end this entire long-winded rap by just giving my new invention and giving my favorite example of my newest invention back there at the very end. And then I say in conclusion, you aren't welcome in my dojo. I say that because it's the name of the song. It's the name of the rap of the verse. And, you know, again, the dojo, it's just a metaphorical place for saying, okay, only legends, only the greats are allowed here. You just random nobodies can't come here. You have to be amazing. You have to be adept. You got to be at the top of the game. Okay, you have to be godlike. And I'm not in this game for nothing. I am in this game, this rap game, to specifically show my talent and to let it proliferate all over the internet and the world and as far as I can possibly go. And I'm showing it time and time again with my technical skill that I apply into my lyrics. And I'm saying, so you, and I don't mean you as in the audience, I'm saying you as in whack rappers and as people that are not writers themselves and stuff like that. I'm saying you're not welcome. I'm saying this is a place for the greatest types of writers. Okay, thank you guys for listening. If you have any questions, feel free to comment. Send me any messages. If there's anything about these rhymes that you feel like I can help you explain more or more thoroughly or give you guys some answers to other types of questions to do with my material, I'd be happy to help you out. Thank you all for listening.